More than likely, we won't be here the whole time tonight because I don't want to go through, or I don't intend to go through The Hobbit chapter by chapter. I mean, there are some chapters we'll skip. I want to discuss what I think are important points embedded within. And the reason I want to do that is because this tale is radically different than The Lord of the Rings. How many of you know the story about how Tolkien began this? Anybody?
Okay. Like a bedtime story for his children, yes?
No. Oh. I mean, it became that.
Okay.
It originally began, and I mean, its origin was, Tolkien was summer of 1930, 1931, something like that. I would have to double check to make sure. Tolkien was sitting in the room over his garage. I believe it was June. And he was marking entrance exams to, at that time, I believe he was at Pembroke College. But he was marking entrance exams to Oxford. Okay? Blue books, essentially. And he's reading one, and he turns the page, and he writes on the black, on the blank backside, "In a hole in the ground there lived a hobbit." And he goes on to the next, starts reading the next essay by this student. When he writes that sentence, "In a hole in the ground there lived a hobbit," he had no idea what it meant. Okay? But he went home and started to think about it. Well, what kind of hole? What is a hobbit, etc.? And he began from that. He began developing stories or a story for his children. His youngest child at that point, or at that time, Christopher Tolkien, would have been, I think, about 10 or so. Because he later fought with our RAF in North Africa during World War II, and he probably would have been at least 18 when he went off to there. That's how it began. He then starts telling it to his children, and the literary group that arose around Tolkien and C.S. Lewis, they would meet together. That's the, you know, the group that this course is named for, the Inklings. They would meet together usually twice a week, once in the evening, once in the morning. Often they would meet in Lewis's rooms at Magdalen College. If they didn't meet there, then they would meet at the Eagle and Child Pub, which is also nicknamed the Bird and Baby. And what they would do at these meetings is they would read aloud what they were reading, what they were writing. So Tolkien began reading, okay, the drafts of The Hobbit. He was already reading some of his stories of Middle Earth, a material that later gets published as The Silmarillion. Lewis would read a little bit later. Wait, take that back. Lewis would read portions of his early critical work, The Allegory of Love, published in either, it's either 1933 or 1936. And they didn't do this for a, you know, mutual flattery society. They did it for criticism. And pretty much the members of this group, Lewis and Tolkien were kind of the core members, but then there was Owen Barfield and Hugo Dyson and a variety of other people around it. Tolkien's son became kind of a quasi-member in the 40s. What they would do is they, you know, they would read a paper and then the others would make comments, sometimes negative comments, but usually constructive comments. Here's where I think you could improve this argument, or, you know, that turn of phrase isn't quite right. And we know from, for example, from The Lord of the Rings, or let's say the Middle Earth material, Tolkien was a prolific rewriter. Okay. One of the reasons for that, probably, or possibly I should say, is because of the criticism he received from the members of the Inklings. Okay? He really valued Lewis's input, and Lewis really valued Tolkien's input. Lewis also highly valued Charles Williams's input. Charles Williams was another influential member of the Inklings, but he didn't really become a member of the Inklings until the late 30s. Okay, but he had already become an influence on Lewis, which Tolkien didn't really like. Tolkien thought Williams's influence was... don't want to use the word bad. It was harmful, let's say. Tolkien thought Lewis was too easily influenced, which is kind of hard to believe, but there it is. So this begins out of the blue. I mean, it begins almost like the way J.K. Rowling's Harry Potter story begins, you know. She's on that train from Manchester to London. One moment she knows nothing about Harry Potter and Lord Voldemort and murdered parents, blah, 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 blah. And a second later, that idea is fully formed in her mind. You know, and 15 years later, she's a billionaire. Okay? So, we get this, you know, this opening. When we go through all that we're going to, keep in the back of your mind what Tolkien says about fairy stories. And how well does this apply or fit to what he says about fairy stories? In a hole in the ground, there lived a hobbit. What's one of the characterizations, or what's one of the attributes of fantasy? Two. Arresting strangeness. A what it? A hobbit. Not a nasty, dirty, wet hole filled with the ends of worms and an oozy smell, nor yet a dry, bare, sandy hole with nothing in it to sit down on or to eat. It was a hobbit hole, and that means comfort. So you get this little description, and then he's going to go on and give us a much fuller description of Bag End, which I'm not going to go into all of. Okay? So we start with that arresting strangeness. Again, when this hits the shelves in 1937, nobody has any idea what a hobbit is. They've never heard or seen any story like this before. Okay? It becomes an international bestseller. Now, how did Tolkien go from In a Hole in the Ground There Lived a Hobbit in the summer of 1930 or 1931 to the actual book? Any of you know that story? He writes up the story and he sends it off to a publisher in London, Stanley Unwin. Stanley Unwin gets this manuscript. Actually, I don't think it's typed. I think it might be manuscript. Anyways, he gets this manuscript, let's call it, and he doesn't know what to do with it because it's titled The Hobbit or There and Back Again. And he's like, what's a hobbit? And because he doesn't have the time to spend on it, he gives it to his 10-year-old son, Rainer Unwin. And he asks his 10-year-old son to read it and write him a report. Okay? His son dutifully reads it, and he writes his father, I think it is, a couple-page report in which he says that essentially this is a classic. Okay, this is a 10-year-old. But keep in mind, this is a 10-year-old who's educated in England in the mid-1930s. Okay, so he is probably speaking, or probably knows, Latin, and maybe a smattering of Greek. Okay, he's very well bred, very well educated. In fact, he says that it is a fairy, he says something to the effect of, it is a fairy tale fitting for those from 5 to 85, or something like that. Okay, writes this nice little letter, and on the basis of that, his father agrees to print it. Okay, so what does this say, first of all, about Stanley Unwin and his son, Rainer?
He trusts his opinion.
He trusts his opinion, okay? Because it's not cheap to take a manuscript or typescript, set it into type, okay? Back then as Linotype.
Especially when he hasn't actually read it himself.
he does read it after his son says that. You know, and then Prince, I believe the first impression, I'd have to check Doug Anderson's work on this in the Annotated Hobbit, I think. I think the first impression, there were 1,500 copies. They sell out. So they print a second impression, a second printing, which I think had 5,000 copies. They sell out. And so the wheels start to turn in Stanley Unwin's mind. This is selling out. They start printing more copies, and they sell out. It becomes essentially an international bestseller, even though there were no New York Times bestseller lists that I'm aware of, in 1937. Tolkien becomes famous. He starts receiving letters after the publication of The Hobbit, okay? Because people want to know more, for example, and he tells us this in the foreword to the second edition of The Lord of the Rings. People want to know more about people like Elrond, Gandalf, the High Elves of Gondolin, and who they are and what they were, and where is Gondolin and what happened to it and all that kind of stuff. So they read this. They get an introduction to this world called the Middle Earth. And then they have to wait 17 years to get their fix, you know, filled. And when they get that fix filled, when the first volume of The Lord of the Rings comes out, what are they expecting? For example, let's say you read this in 1937. Let's say you're 12 years old in 1937 and you read this. Okay, first of all, you have to wait 17 years, so now you're 29. Okay, you've probably moved on to some extent, but what are your memories of, say, Elrond and Rivendell and the elves of Rivendell?
Probably expecting something very lighthearted.
They're happy.
Together in the end.
They make fun of dwarves.
They sing silly songs.
Yeah.
You know, they're jolly.
Yeah.
You know? And what do you get?
They're not jolly anymore. Things are less happy now.
Okay, that's a good way of putting it. It's a somber world. It's a dark world. Okay? What about Gandalf? Is he cool because of fireworks? No, there's a little bit more to Gandalf than that, okay? So it's like the world changes. But then, what's the difference between 1937 and 1954? Or about 1952 when he really finishes all the revising?
World War II
has happened. Okay? A lot has changed in the world. But Tolkien will tell us in that foreword to the second edition of The Lord of the Rings that a lot of the changes, that is, a lot of the dark things that he writes about in The Lord of the Rings, that was foreseen before the outbreak of World War II.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? It's just, you know, kind of World War II follows essentially the war in here to some extent because there are major areas where it doesn't. Okay, so, having said all that, skip a couple pages, and on page 4 in this edition, I don't know what it is in yours, the paragraph that begins, this is only like 2 or 3 pages in. By some curious chance, one morning long ago, in the quiet of the world, notice the editorial comment. Now, when there was less noise and more green. Okay. What does that little editorial comment say?
This is not written by Bilbo. Or do you mean like what it actually says, or just...
What does it imply?
It's set in our world.
Okay. What else? It's set in our world when there was less noise and more green. What is there now? More noise and less green. Okay. Tolkien hated the internal combustion engine. There's a famous story, and I think this is on the A&E biography of Tolkien. Right? You could probably watch on YouTube. And if I remember correctly, the story is told by his son, Christopher Tolkien, that I think it is he and his father were out for a walk somewhere in the west country of England, I think. And they were on a hillside, and down below, his father saw a train coming. Steam train, you know, or diesel train maybe. But there was smoke or steam billowing out. And Christopher Tolkien thought, this is the coolest thing. I mean, he was 10 or 15 at the time. He loved trains, etc. And thought that's just, you know, the most wonderful thing. And Tolkien said something to the effect of, no, it's not. That monster is carrying people to their slavery. Because he saw the train as an instrument of technology to do what? To take people to and from work. But what are they doing going to work? What are they missing in the train?
Scenery.
Yeah. They're missing the world. Okay? So they're in the bullet. And they're missing everything around them. All right? When there is less noise and more green, Gandalf shows up. Knocks on the door. Bilbo answers. Bilbo says, good morning. Okay, what kind of response is that?
Polite.
Yeah, it's polite. You know, you say hello to somebody. Somebody walks by you in the hallway. They say hello. You don't flip them off. You don't, you know, say something rude. You don't ignore them. That's rude. Bilbo says, good morning. And he meant it. Okay, now notice that. Because what does Gandalf take from good morning?
Lots of things.
Exactly. What do you mean? Okay. One of C.S. Lewis's teachers, a tutor that he had, a private tutor, he went lived with him for a year or two, whose name was Kirkpatrick, but he was just called the Great Knock. Okay. The guy was an atheist, and he taught Lewis to always ask questions. That is, whatever was said to you, take it apart. Ask questions. Find out what the real meaning. Find out what the real intent is. I don't know if that influenced Tolkien here or not. But it almost sounds like Gandalf has an element of that teacher of Lewis's here. What do you mean? Notice what he does. He immediately takes that statement, removes it from its context of, it's a bright sunny morning, Bilbo's sitting outside, you know, and says, do you wish me a good morning? Or mean that it is a good morning whether I want it or not? Or that you feel good this morning? Or that it is a morning to be good on? Notice, those are four very different things. All of them, Bilbo says. Everything. That is, you take the words good morning and you apply to them whatever you want.
Sounds like ability.
Okay. So why is Gandalf there? He's looking for a burglar. Or, at this point, he just says, you know, I'm looking for someone to go out on an adventure. Bilbo, adventure? No, we don't like adventures here. But Gandalf just stands there, staring at him. And you've all been in a situation, probably, where somebody won't leave. They just stand there, or they keep talking, or they stare at you. And Bilbo says, finally, good morning! He probably intones it differently to give that hint of finality. I'm leaving now. You can walk away. We don't want any adventures here. Thank you. You might try over the, you know, hill across the water. What a lot of good things you do use good morning for. Now you mean you want to get rid of me. In other words, now you don't mean that you wish me a good morning. Okay? No. Notice, Bilbo doesn't want to appear to be impolite. So what does he do? Come tomorrow for tea. He goes inside, after they talk about who Gandalf is and fireworks and all that. He goes inside and he thinks, why did I invite him to tea? Okay, he's been invited. So now Gandalf can come back. Just before Gandalf leaves, we find out he scratches the G rune on the door. And what happens the next day? the dwarves all show up. One, sometimes two or three at a time, but Bilbo has to feed them. They help put all the crockery and everything away after dinner. And we get the scene, page 14. They put everything away except for their pipes. So they break out their pipes and Thorin's harp. And we hear the dwarves sing. Actually, I should have brought this up on YouTube because this is a good scene in the film.
Honestly, it started out so well, didn't it?
Far over the misty mountains cold, to dungeons deep and caverns old, we must away or break of day to seek the pale enchanted gold. Notice the rhythm of that. It's ballad rhythm. It's designed to get into your brain and kind of knock away at it. The dwarves of yore made mighty spells while hammers fell like ringing bells in places deep where darkening sleep in hollow halls beneath the fells. For ancient king and elvish lord, their many a gleaming golden hoard, they shaped and wrought and light they caught to hide in gems on the hilt of sword. Now, I don't know about you, but this song or this poem is much better than any of the poems the elves sing in The Hobbit. In The Lord of the Rings, it's the other way around. Okay? On silver necklaces they strung the flowering stars, on crowns they hung the dragon fire and twisted wire. They meshed the light of moon and sun. Far over the misty mountains cold, to dungeons deep and caverns old, we must away or break of day to claim our long forgotten gold. Blah, 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 blah. So they sing all this, and what does it do to Bilbo? It enchants him. I mean, do any of you, is there any kind of music that really just, you know, grabs your soul? For me, it's pipe. Oh, what's that? Was that in here or out there?
Wasn't me.
That was strange. For me, it's bagpipes, okay? It kind of, you know, awakens my Scottish blood, okay? That's what this is doing for Bilbo. He's not a dwarf. He doesn't have any dwarvish blood in him. But we've been told he has Tookish blood in him. And the Tooks are adventurous hobbits. And Bilbo's kind of, you know, he's been living fat, dumb, and happy for the last 50 years. As they sang, the hobbit felt the love of beautiful things made by hands and by cunning and by magic moving through him. A fierce and a jealous love. The desire of the hearts of dwarves. Notice, the dwarves have been able to put into word the desire of their hearts. Then something Tookish woke up inside him, and he wished to go and see the great mountains and hear the pine trees and the waterfalls and explore the caves and wear a sword instead of a walking stick. He looked out of the window. He sees the stars. He thought of the jewels of the dwarves shining in dark caverns. Suddenly in the wood beyond the water a flame leapt up, probably somebody lighting a wood fire, and he thinks of plundering dragons, etc., etc. Okay? He asks for a little light, they don't give him any, etc. And what happens for the rest of the evening? What do they talk about? Plans.
Yeah.
Contracts. You know, Bilbo asks, and Thorin goes on. I'm going to skip a bit. Let's see here. Actually, before they discuss the contract, on page 19, you know, Bilbo got a little overexcited. He went out, he comes back in, or they take him out, he comes back in, and we hear Glorin talking. And he says, yes, yes, but that was long ago. I was talking about you, that is. And I assure you, there's a mark on this door, the usual one in the trade, or used to be. Burglar wants a good job, plenty of excitement, reasonable reward. You can say expert treasure hunter instead of burglar if you like. Some of them do. It's all the same to us. Gandalf told us there was a man of the sword in these parts looking for a job at once. And he'd arrange for a meeting here at this a meeting here this Wednesday. Gandalf, of course, there's a mark. I put it there. You asked me to find the 14th man for your expedition. I chose Mr. Baggins. Just let anyone say I chose the wrong man or the wrong house so you could stop at 13 and have all the bad luck you like or go back to digging coal. Okay? They need 14. Why? Because 13's an unlucky number. I think they need 14 for another reason.
Cowards. They need, they need somebody to actually do the dangerous stuff for them.
Okay, that's going to be the job of burglar. So that's a little bit different. In Beowulf, how many men leave the land of the Geats or Gates and go to Denmark? Go to Hrothgar's Hall.
15. Yeah, okay.
How many set off on this quest? 15. Okay. In Beowulf, once the cup is stolen from the dragon at the end of the poem, how many men go off on the quest to find the dragon's barrow? 15. It's Beowulf. 13 men and the thief who stole the cup. Okay. So there's 15 if I remember correctly. So
I guess they have 15 including Gandalf.
Yes, they have 15 including Gandalf. So Gandalf pulls out the map, shows it to Thorin and such. And they kind of make their route how they're going to go. And we hear on page 21 an interesting little statement. It's kind of like they're running their fingers on, and Thorin says, he points at Long Lake. And Gandalf says, and that's where Thorin says, after that we might start having some trouble. Gandalf says, a little bit before that. Okay. We might go from there up along the river running, went on Thorin, taking no notice, and so to the ruins of Dale, the old town in the valley there. But we none of us like the idea of the front gate. The river runs right out of it through the great cliff at the south of the mountains. And out of it comes the dragon too, far too often, unless he's changed his habits. In other words, Thorin's saying, this is what we might do. We might go to the front door and knock. Gandalf, that would be no good, not without a mighty warrior, even a hero. Notice there's a distinction between a mighty warrior and a hero. I tried to find one.
Because a hero isn't necessarily a mighty warrior.
I tried to find one, but warriors are busy fighting one another in distant lands. Okay? And in this neighborhood, heroes are scarce or simply not to be found. Notice, warriors are fighting each other. Heroes are scarce. Just because you're a hero doesn't mean you're a warrior. Just because you're a warrior doesn't mean you're a hero. Swords in these parts, what does he mean in these parts? Does he mean in Hobbiton? No, he means from Hobbiton to the mountain. Swords in these parts are mostly blunt, and axes are used for trees, and shields as cradles or dish covers. What does that mean? Shields are used as cradles or dish covers. They haven't had war in a long time. And dragons are comfortably far off and therefore legendary. If they're not right here, they merely become the things of stories. That is why I settled on burglary. Especially I remembered the existence of a side door. In other words, Gandalf says, we're not going to make a frontal assault. We just need somebody to nick in and steal something.
Never make a frontal assault upon a superior force in an entrenched position.
Okay. And what's the motto of Hogwarts? Never awaken a sleeping dragon. Or never tickle a sleeping dragon. Okay. And so he says, and here's our little Bilbo Baggins, the burglar. Okay. So they talk a little bit. Thorin tells the story of how the dwarves got to be rich and all this kind of stuff. And he talks a little bit about dragons, top of 23. Dragons steal gold and jewels, you know, from men and elves and dwarves, wherever they can find them. They guard their plunder as long as they live, which is practically forever unless they're killed. And they never enjoy a brass ring of it. That is, what do dragons not do with any material in their hoard? They don't use it at all. Okay? Indeed, they hardly know a good bit of work from a bad. Though they usually have a good notion of the current market value. Now, doesn't that language, current market value, kind of sound out of place a little bit? It's like, but they know what the ticker tape says for the current value of dwarf gold or dwarf silver, mithril, you know? And then he goes on and talks about Smaug. That's on page 23. We're going to skip a bunch again. Bilbo goes to sleep. The dwarves leave in the morning. They leave Bilbo behind. They leave him a note. Gandalf shows up to get him moving. And they make their way off. They run into the trolls. And notice what the dwarves say. Actually, before they get to the trolls, they're in the woods. It's raining. It's dark. They feel miserable. They see the light. And what do they tell Bilbo? Middle of 32. After all, we have got a burglar with us. Gregor.
So I got the impression from the book after, none of the dwarves here were actually present when Smaug originally attacked, right?
Thorin was, and I think Balin was. Balin's really old. Thorin's well over 100 years old.
Okay. All right.
Not like the Thorin in the movie.
Well, you know, he's a dwarf. You know, he could be as whatever age they want.
No, he's not at all like the Thorin in the movie.
Although he was definitely there in the movie.
In fact, I was rereading just before class, and I was going over the towards the end of the book where you get the clouds burst, page 256. So began a battle that none had expected. It was called the Battle of Five Armies. And the Battle of Five Armies is 4 pages long. And it's been made into a self-standing film.
Well, no, they're killing Smaug in the third one as well. He's not dead at the end of the second one.
Well, okay.
So, there's that. And they also have to shove in they're also going to kill the Necromancer. They're also going to defeat the Necromancer in the third movie.
Okay.
They basically saved all the exciting stuff for the third
movie. The Necromancer was literally a lie.
8 pages.
Yeah.
Yes, Rocco Grand Total of 8 pages.
Yeah, the Necromancer one was...
Glad we got that settled.
By the way, when I was off doing my own thing, we got rid of the Necromancer, so that was cool.
Which I thought that was going to be more of what they added in, but they kept adding in stuff that they just made up.
So they say, we have a burglar. And so they made off to the light. Okay, now what is Bilbo's task on this journey?
Steal gold.
Yeah, to get into the Lonely Mountain. Here they've not gone, you know, too far in terms of the overall distance. And they're already saying, time to earn your keep, so to speak. Now it is the burglar's turn. You must go on and find out all about that light and what it is for and if all is perfectly safe and canny. Now scuttle off, come back quick, if all is well. If not, come back if you can. If you can't, hoot twice like a barn owl, once like a screech owl. Bilbo goes off and he's like, I can't screech like any owl, okay? Notice they get captured by the trolls. Gandalf comes and saves the day, which I'm going to skip all that. They find the troll horde, and they pull out weapons from it. I've got to find the pages where I marked them. And on page 49, they've made their way to Rivendell. And Elrond is instructing them about runes. And he says, or the book says, Elrond knew all about runes of every kind. That day he looked at the swords that they had brought from their troll's lair, and he said, these are not troll make. They are old swords, very old swords of the high elves of the west, my kin. They were made in Gondolin for the Goblin Wars. They must have come from a dragon's hoard or goblin plunder, for dragons and goblins destroyed that city many ages ago. This, Thorin, the rune's name Orcrist, the goblin cleaver in the ancient tongue of Gondolin. It was a famous blade. This, Gandalf, was Glamdring, foe hammer that the king of Gondolin once wore. Keep them well. Notice what Elrond doesn't do. That he kind of has every right to do.
Take them.
Yeah. I mean, he could claim them. Yes?
Is this one of the passages that was changed in the second edition? So I was reading that Tolkien changed some of the history to better match The Lord of the Rings.
Well,
in the second edition of The Hobbit, you mean? Yes. The one that came out in 54 or 55?
The High Elves. Specifically were called something else, I thought.
Well, I know that he changed some of the descriptions of the in particular and some of the stuff involved with
It's almost like he aged it more dramatically. That seemed to be what I read.
Yeah, I don't think so. I'd have to check. I've got Doug Anderson's The Annotated Hobbit. I don't think he does. I think the major changes are merely in the chapter Riddles in the Dark, where he essentially rewrites it.
Yeah,
and the riddles change a little bit, and then what Bilbo tells them about the ring and such, he changes. But I'll check that.
I think there's more added about, like, the ring takes on a slightly more sinister tone in the second edition than it did in the first. Because I think, if I remember correctly, I've actually read the two different versions of it.
And it's very hard to get a copy of the first. I mean, if you find one for sale, there. Last time I saw one for sale, it was like $75,000.
Well, I mean, you know, there's always internet.
So. So they keep talking with Elrond. Elrond reads the runes, reads the moon runes for them, tells them about the door, Endurance Day, etc., etc. We're going to skip a bunch again. Go to the chapter 4, Over Hill and Under Hill. They make their way to the Misty Mountains. They're on the mountains. It's night. There's thunder. There's lightning. The rock giants are throwing, you know, rocks back and forth. And Thorin says, this won't do at all. I'm only reading this because of one little comment that he makes that I've read this, I don't know, a dozen times, and it's the first time this hit me. It just kind of struck me odd. This won't do at all, said Thorin. If we don't get blown off or drowned or struck by lightning, we shall be picked up by some giant and kicked sky high for a football. What? Football, by the way, he's not talking American football. He means a soccer ball. Isn't that a little out of place?
Well, Gandalf mentions golf.
Yeah. Well, we find out that golf is invented by Bulwer Took knocking off a goblin's head, and the goblin's name is Golf Thimble. Okay. But football? Really?
He might not be thinking specifically the football. Surely there.
What else would it? What else context would it mean to an audience in 1937 in England?
But still, like, you know, there's.
No, I mean.
I thought the same thing when I read it. I was like, what? Okay.
There's one or two other passages like that, not where you have reference to, you know, a sporting object, but, you know, like the comment about current market value.
Yeah.
Where it seems like Tolkien is intentionally. How do I want to put this? The current market value comment seems to me that it's Tolkien's kind of way of linking this with our world. Mm-hmm. That he doesn't want it to be so totally out of the norm. And maybe this also, that this is, you know, his way of putting in the mouth of Thorin something that keeps it rooted here, so that the audience doesn't kind of get totally unmoored from reality. That's my only guess.
All three of the comics are also decidedly lighthearted.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You don't really get that kind of stuff in Lord of the Rings either. He's perfectly happy for you to be as unmoored as you'd like.
No, but I think that's one of the reasons why it essentially, you know, it takes him. He began writing Lord of the Rings actually before this was published. You know, it takes him, you know, 17 years or so to write The Lord of the Rings. And I think one of the reasons it does so is because he's going through line by line and meticulously removing stuff. Okay? He says, you know, in one of his letters, that The Lord of the Rings is fundamentally a religious and philosophical work. And he says, more so in the revising than in the creation. So he writes it and various drafts of it, and then as he goes through, he doesn't sit down and say, how can I make this more Catholic? It just becomes that way because of his cast of mind, because of his outlook on life and such. Anyways, they get captured by the goblins, and we're told about the goblins, page 59. Paragraph that begins, there in the shadows on a large flat stone sat a tremendous goblin with a huge head. I want to skip down to about the middle of that paragraph, where the narrator talks about hammers and axes and all these other things. Instruments of torture and such. It is not unlikely that they invented some of the machines that have since troubled the world, especially the ingenious devices for killing large numbers of people at once. For wheels and engines and explosions always delighted them, and also not working with their own hands more than they could help. Now, there's an awful lot packed into that little sentence, okay? By saying it's not unlikely, what does Tolkien really mean?
It
is likely that they invented some of the machines that have since troubled the world. Okay. Notice, machines trouble the world. Especially the ingenious devices for killing large numbers of people at once. Bombs. I mean, he mentions explosives. Why do we have a Nobel Peace Prize? Anybody know?
Because of all the people who won all the other prizes?
Nope. Because it's either Albert or Alfred. Nobel was the person who invented dynamite. And he realized very, very soon thereafter what dynamite would be used for. It wouldn't be used for mining. It is used for mining. He realized it would be used for war. It would be used to kill people. And so he wanted to set up an award against killing. I mean, a lot of people said he did this to try to assuage his guilt, because he realized, I let the genie out of this bottle and there's no putting it back.
Try to remove his stain from his...
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. Okay. For wheels and engines and explosions always delighted them. Notice, I mean, it's not that Tolkien is against wheels. But what did come with the advent of the wheel?
Carts and
carts and wagons in movability, nomadic lifestyle, or a more easily nomadic lifestyle, etc. I've got a fantastic book in my office called The Horse, the Wheel, and Language, about the rise of the Indo-European peoples in the steppes of southern Russia in the period 7,000 to 5,000 BC, etc. And explosions always delighted them, and also not working with their own hands more than they could help. Notice, what do the dwarves like to do? They like to build stuff. They're smiths, they're craftsmen. Okay? Goblins? No. Trolls? No. What do? They steal from others. Elves? Yes. Okay? But in those days and those wild parts, they had not advanced, as it is called, so far. See, Tolkien did not consider the advent of new machinery and new technology progress. He considered it really a regression. Why? What do these things and these things enable us? And, you know, electric lights. What do they do?
They make things easier.
They make things easier. Okay, what else do they do?
Well, they unmoor you from the day-night cycle so that you can have, you know, classes.
Okay. They unmoor you from the day and night cycle, or from the sun and the moon and nature. They disconnect you from the world. That's what they do. You can't, quote unquote, reach out and touch someone with this. Sending an email is not the same as talking face to face.
Or even a letter.
Okay? But even a letter is not the same as talking face-to-face. What can't you do via the written word?
Inflections,
intonations, which is why people often get in trouble sending an email, right? You can't tell what is sometimes meant sarcastically and what isn't, or what is meant humorously and what isn't, okay? Tolkien buries these little comments in his works that kind of reflect his mentality on life. Well, what has happened? People have become too far removed from the world, nature. I mean, after all, what are we told repeatedly about Bilbo? What can he do? Even before he has the ring, he can disappear. He can move stealthily. Why? Because he's connected. He's rooted to the world, to the ground. It's one of the reasons hobbits go around barefoot. It shows their connection.
And that's why hobbits are so easily missed by men, because the world's growing around them and they're not paying attention to it.
And what do men usually do? I mean, you get this description really in The Lord of the Rings. They're big, blundering fools who make all kinds of noise. Whereas hobbits kind of like tiptoe. They see a stick, they step over it. The big blundering fool man steps on it, cracks it, and everybody within, you know, 100 yards hears it, so to speak. They did not, that is, goblins, hate dwarves especially, no more than they hated everybody and everything. That is, they hate everything. Okay? What are goblins for the Lord of the Rings? Orcs. Orcs. Notice. Tolkien doesn't give them the orc name here. It is used once or twice.
I thought they were different.
Well, I mean, in Lord of the Rings there are orcs, and occasionally he'll talk about other kinds of goblins. Like, orcs are kind of like, I guess, mainly described sort of like almost like a larger, more scary goblin.
Not really. I mean, he makes it clear they're interchangeable. It's just in this story, we have goblins in the English language, and we have hobgoblins in the English language. Here, a hobgoblin is a larger goblin. It's not a different form or different species of goblin. It's not a, you know, North American goblin versus a South American goblin, or a, you know, English sparrow versus an African sparrow. It's, you know, okay? It's just a bigger-bodied goblin. But he uses the word goblins here because, one, in his children's minds, okay, and in his audience's minds, they already have some connotation with goblin. Now, he's going to alter it, obviously, with the descriptions of the goblins. But he's creating word paintings for audiences, okay, so that they can conjure up for themselves images of these. When you get to the Lord of the Rings and you meet orcs, they're a little bit different. Because what do we see here? Page 58. Clap, 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 snap the black crack. Grip, grab, punch, nab. And down, down to Goblin Town you go, my lad. The goblins sing. Okay? If they sing, What might that possibly say about them?
They're more lighthearted. Not good, but okay. Lighthearted and less
tax. I'm trying to think of ways to put this. Can it be that they're less evil than the orcs? Yeah. But you get to the Lord of the Rings,
and the
orcs sink.
In The Hobbit, too, the goblins can kind of be reasoned with, in a sense. It doesn't work, but there's a sense that, the dwarves think, they could probably even negotiate their way out of this.
Yeah, I mean, Thorin tries to butter him up, calls him, oh, you great.
And it almost works.
Where is it?
Find the swords.
Thorin says...
Thorin the dwarf at your service.
Yeah, I thought he actually addressed him in some language, but he doesn't. He just says, I'm at your service. I thought he called him your great something or other at one point.
Truly tremendous
one. There it is right in front of me. Several of our people were struck by lightning. No, that's one of the drivers who says that. It's not Thorin. Okay, so Gandalf shows up, lops off the great orc's head, great goblin's head, and leads the dwarves, and Bilbo gets dropped off. He literally smacks his head on a low-hanging wall, and he wakes up on chapter 5. He gets up. He's groping around on all fours. Notice it's pitch black. His head is swimming. It probably means he has a ringing headache. In his hand, finds a ring. You can tell immediately by the shape what it is. He picks it up and puts it in his pocket. He can't think what to do, so he goes down the trail. We're told hobbits. We have friends named the Hobbs, and we call their little kids the Hobbits. We're told he follows the path, and that hobbits have excellent sense of direction. Okay? He makes it all the way down until he comes to a pool where he meets Gollum. And Bilbo, when Gollum asks him, who are you? Bilbo says, page 69, I am Mr. Bilbo Baggins. I've lost the dwarves, I've lost the wizard, I don't know where I am, and I don't want to know, if only I can get away. Now, what has he just done? I've lost the dwarves, I'm not alone, I'm with some dwarves. I've lost the wizard, I'm not alone, I'm with the wizard. Okay? He's kind of giving out information he shouldn't be giving out. Gollum asks, what's he got in his hands is? And Bilbo says, a sword, a blade which came out of Gondolin.
Although you could argue that he's actually being kind of smart here. He's like, the dwarves and the wizards are looking for me, so if
he eats, possibly. So Gollum asks, do you like riddles?
It likes riddles, perhaps it does it?
Okay. Bilbo says, very well, Gollum, you ask first. So Gollum hisses.
What is roots as nobody sees, as taller than trees, up it goes, and yet never grows?
Bilbo, it's easy, mounds.
Doesn't guess easy, must have a competition with us, my precious. If precious asks and it doesn't answer, we eat it, my precious. If it asks us and we doesn't answer, then we does it at once, eh?
Notice, it isn't, then it eats us. It's just, we do what you want.
We shows it the way out, yes.
So Bilbo says, all right. And he thinks... 30 white horses on a red hill. First they champ, then they stamp, then they stand still.
Gollum, teeth, my precious, but we has only 6.
So then he asks one.
Voiceless it cries, wingless flutters, toothless bites, mouthless mutters.
Bilbo realizes what it is. Okay. So he says one to Gollum. Notice they go back and forth. And then Gollum thinks he's come up with a pretty good one.
It cannot be seen, cannot be felt, cannot be heard, cannot be smelt. It lies behind stars and under hills, in empty holes it fills. It comes first and follows after, ends life, kills laughter.
Dark, Bilbo guesses. And so he says one without even thinking about it, which turns out to be eggs. Gollum says, alive without breath, as cold as death, never thirsty, ever drinking, Ullin male, never clinking. And finally, what helps Bilbo? Because notice, he stumped on this one. A fish plops out of the water. Fish! So, Bilbo asks another one. Not intending it to be the, you know, the coup de grace, the big one that would stump Gollum. He asked one very quickly to get Gollum to go back to his boat. To get him, you know. No legs lay on one leg, two legs sat near on three legs, four legs got some. Gollum, fish on a little table, man at table sitting on a stool, the cat has the bones. And then Gollum thinks he has the winning one. This thing all thing devours, birds, beasts, trees, flowers, gnaws iron, bites steel, grinds hard stones to meal, slays king, ruins town, and beats high mountain down. Now, before we talk about that one, what's going on here? What does this riddle game tell us about Bilbo and Gollum?
They
both know a lot of riddles.
The obvious thing. You know,
what might that show?
They might have a common background.
I mean, you would expect if they both understand riddles, they both know the same riddles. Okay, riddles are a part of what's called oral culture. They are things that get passed down orally over time. There's an old English manuscript called the Exeter Manuscript that contains, I'm trying to remember the exact number. It's either 60 or 100 riddles. I mean, in some of them are fairly easy. Some of them are really, really hard. In fact, there are several that haven't been definitively solved. Okay. What I hate is old English textbooks that give several of the riddles and then they give the solution. Many of them are double entendre riddles. I mean, you can read them and it can be something innocuous like a key, or a solution can, or it can be something entirely else. Okay. This one very classic one has two solutions, a key or a penis. Okay? Keep in mind, these things are written and copied down by monks in monasteries. The one for an onion is very suggestive.
I remember when I read those for your 3010 class, although I don't think we were supposed to read them. But I remember reading them and just being I would go down the riddles and just be like, it could be this or a penis. And it was basically all that was a good chunk of the riddles. Like, it could be one thing or a penis.
Yeah, yeah.
That's really bizarre.
I was going to say with the riddles, we also learned something of the nature of Gollum's brand of evil. He's very natural. It's all darkness and time versus machines and cogs and wheels.
Yeah, and it's, you know, the things that he thinks of, you know, go back to them from the beginning. You know, Gollum says, you know, you like riddles and stuff. And Gollum hisses, what's the first one? Okay, mountains. Well, where are they? In the roots of the mountains. They're beneath the mountains. So Bilbo tells his and their teeth. Next one Gollum sings, voiceless it cries. What's that? It's wind. But that's something Gollum hasn't, you know, we don't know this yet. By the time you get midway through The Lord of the Rings, you find out not even midway, you find out, you know, Gollum hasn't experienced wind in probably several hundred years, except for very, very recently, when he left his tunnel, went out down to Sauron and stuff like that. Okay? So then Bilbo says the one about the daisies, and then Gollum has his other one. Cannot be seen, cannot be felt, cannot be heard, cannot be smelt. What is it? It's what inhabits Gollum's, or what, you know, Gollum lives in all the time. Darkness. Okay? So Gollum's thinking primarily of kind of elemental things. Alive without breath, as cold as death, never thirsty, ever drinking. It's pretty much what he lives on. Fish.
Now, you mentioned that this was pretty much rewritten for the second edition. Now, like, this all, like, what we said, like, the sort of information we gleaned from this were, like, you know, they seem to have a common origin, you mm-hmm. know, and things like that. That obviously was something that's expounded upon in Lord of the Rings, but is that... Like,
yeah.
Do you still get that same information from the first edition text, or...
Of this?
Yeah,
no,
of, like,
no.
The scene. Like, they don't seem to have a common origin. I mean, it still plays some sort of...
No, place. No. I mean, all it seems here is that, you know... They are both part of a riddle culture, mm-hmm. let's say. It's in the Lord of the Rings when Gandalf explains to Frodo, you know, it's not an accident that Gollum and Bilbo both knew the same riddles, because he's trying to explain to Frodo at that point, this is in the chapter The Shadow of the Past, that they derive from a common heritage. And, you know, that just... irks Frodo to no end. You know, how can we be essentially cousins? Because Gollum is thoroughly bad, and I am not. Okay.
With these changes that inform the Lord of the Rings, do you think that Tolkien maybe didn't know how much The Hobbit was going to be informing that world? I know he knew they were going to be the same world, but, like, just
yeah.
the ring being so essential and Gollum being so essential, and these events. Informing those so heavily.
Well, you know, like I said, he had already begun writing the later material, The Lord of the Rings, before the publication of The Hobbit. He didn't begin writing The Lord of the Rings before he completed The Hobbit. Okay? So he had already written The Hobbit, and it's in writing The Hobbit, and he comes across the ring. Okay? And we get the description of the ring. It's a ring of power, blah, 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 blah. And that it confers invisibility, that Tolkien realizes, okay, this is how I connect kind of this story with the earlier material and then also with later material. Because I would have to go back and check, but if I remember correctly, I think he's already begun writing tales that become part of The Lord of the Rings. Before he's finished this. Okay? And what he has to do is he has to figure out how it's all connected. When he arrives at the ring, here, that becomes the link. Okay? That ties it all together. So, he asks this one of Bilbo, and he sits there, and he's stumped. And he's trying to say, give me more time, give me more time, but all he says is, time. Now Gollum wants to finish. And so he says, it's got to ask us a question, my precious. Yes, yes, yes. Just one more question, Duke. Yes, yes. Did they set out an agreement with how many questions they would ask?
No.
But now Gollum's kind of saying, this is it. Bilbo can't think of any. Gollum's ask us. Bilbo sticks his hands in his pockets. What have I got in my pocket? Not fair. And he's right. That's not a fair question. That's not a riddle.
He makes a fair point of saying that he was not presenting that as a question. He was asking himself. He was
saying,
yeah.
He said that loud. He was talking to himself.
But Gollum thought it was riddle, and he was frightfully upset. Mm-hmm. It isn't fair, my precious. It isn't Taskins what it's got in its nasty little pockets. But Bilbo, seeing what had happened and having nothing better to ask, stuck to his question. It's a question. It's not a riddle. What have I got in my pocket? Must give us three guesses.
my precious, three guesses. Bilbo says, okay.
Takes at that point, it doesn't matter whether it's fair or not. He agreed.
Exactly. I mean, they both agreed to it, so. Gollum goes off to find his precious. He doesn't find it. He comes back. And Bilbo doesn't realize what has happened. Slips the ring on. And Gollum runs past him. Bilbo follows him all the way to page 81. Bilbo almost stopped breathing, went stiff himself. He was desperate he must get away out of this horrible darkness while he had any strength left. He must stab the foul thing, put its eyes out, kill it. It meant to kill him. No, not a fair fight. He was invisible now. Notice what's going on.
Kind of stream of consciousness.
Kind of stream of consciousness, but also kind of telling us what's going on in Bilbo's mind. It meant to kill him. He must fight. He must stab the foul thing. Put its eyes out. Kill it. It meant to kill him. No, not a fair fight. He was invisible now. Gollum had no sword. Gollum had not actually threatened to kill him or tried to yet. I mean, he did say as part of the beginning of the agreement, I'm going to eat you. That usually does imply, you know, you're going to be dead. Hopefully before you.
Yeah, but Bilbo won. So technically the threat isn't valid anymore.
Well... Why might that be interesting?
He's having more immoral thoughts.
Okay. Could this be the beginning influence of the ring?
That's what I thought.
I don't know why.
What does the ring do to Gollum?
Twists him.
It creates two halves. Mm. There's Gollum, and then there's the buried, we see this in The Lord of the Rings, the buried Sméagol. The real entity. Gollum is the, you know, the...
corrupted side.
Yeah, the corrupted side. Okay? So, part of Bilbo thinks, kill it! But another part of thinks, that's not quite fair. And he, this, and Bilbo's now thinking this about Gollum. And he was miserable, alone, lost. A sudden understanding, a pity mixed with horror, welled up in Bilbo's heart. A glimpse of endless unmarked days, without light or hope of betterment. Hard stone, cold fish, sneaking and whispering. And all these thoughts passed in a flash of a second.
Is that empathy and that strength of morality supposed to indicate some... greater stock on the part of the Baggins is? Because it seems like Sméagol's transformation happens much more rapidly. He succumbs to that faster.
Yes, he does. Well, let's use what Gandalf says in that second chapter of The Lord of the Rings, The Shadow of the Past. It's because Bilbo began his ownership of the ring with pity. And I think... by that, what Tolkien says is, earlier in that chapter, he tells Bilbo that if someone takes ownership of the ring, and they take ownership of the ring at the outset with good intentions, the ring will still overcome them, but it will take longer. And so I think what you get here is a juxtaposition of Bilbo's moral nature when he takes possession of the ring, and Sméagol's moral nature when he takes possession of the ring.
So
okay,
that's why Bilbo and Frodo had more of a slow burn, while Sméagol kind of just spiraled.
Because before Sméagol takes possession of the ring, how has Gandalf already described him?
He's jealous.
He's jealous. He's kind of an outcast already. What does the ring do? It just accentuates that. All those negative, you know, character traits that Sméagol already has just get amped up like they're on steroids, okay? So now he takes to sneaking around people. He becomes a thief. You know, he's already become a murderer. He kills Diagol for it, etc. Bilbo's just the opposite. Bilbo has all these thoughts, and we are told he trembled. Okay? Why? He looks at Gollum, and what does he think? Man,
How bad must it be to be him? No, we're told he sees no hope of betterment. No possible change in the future. Okay? If you read Beowulf carefully, and I don't know how carefully you did, just before Beowulf arrives in the land of the Geats, we're told something interesting about Hrothgar. We're told Hrothgar saw no hope for the future. He saw no hope for things ever changing from what they were at that moment in time, which was Grendel coming every night. Okay? And in fact, we're told in a very important passage, lines 170, about lines 175 to 188. And if you have, you know, Tolkien's copy, you can go through and read what he says in the commentary about these lines, because it's pretty interesting. I think he's entirely wrong. But it is pretty interesting. It's the passage where the poet kind of interjects and says that because they were heathen, they had no hope. Or he says they had the hope of the heathen. And what do? They sought out the aid of the soul slayer, the Gastabana in the Old English, the slayer of souls. And then the poet makes this comment. Because they were heathen and they had no hope, what did they do? They sought help from the soul slayer. And he says, woe be to those. Okay. Wildbith fam, he says in the Old English. Woe be to those who, on the death day, cannot or do not hope for any change, any improvement in the future, who must throw their souls in the fire's embrace. But, he says, well be it to those, okay, who, after the death day, are able to seek the embrace of the Father. Okay? The joy of all those, something like all those who suffer. So, what's the poet saying? In Beowulf, the poet is saying, those who don't see any possibility for change in their life, those who don't see any hope in the future, must do what when they die? Receive the fires of hell. But those who do see the possibility of change, who do seek the embrace of the Father, I mean, and it's very Christian language, okay? What does he say they will get? They will find this hope in this peace, okay? Bilbo sees that Gollum experiences no hope for the future. No hope for change. Why is this important? In that chapter, The Shadow of the Past, in The Lord of the Rings, which we'll talk about next week, when Gandalf tells Frodo, I've seen Gollum, and Gollum has told me his whole story, Frodo says, what a pity it is that you did not stab Gollum, or that Bilbo did not stab Gollum when he had the chance. And Gandalf goes on this long thing about, you know, pity and mercy and such. And Frodo says, when Gandalf says, you have not seen him, Frodo says, no, and I don't want to. Gandalf says, he is to be pitied. But then he also says, in that same passage where right after Frodo says, you know, what a pity that Bilbo did not stab him when he had a chance. Gandalf says, pity? It was pity that stayed his hand. Pity and mercy, not to strike without need. And then he goes on and tells Frodo, you know, some people that live deserve death. And some people that die deserve life. Can you give it to them? No? Then don't be too quick to deal out death in judgment. But this is what I wanted to get to. He then says, I have not much hope for Gollum's cure, but there is some before the end of your task. Okay? He's telling Frodo, there is some hope that Gollum can be cured. What does that mean? Hope for betterment. Gandalf is suggesting the door isn't closed on Gollum. He is not written in the book of the evildoers, the book of the dead, the book of the damned. In other words, the judgment is still out. Gollum can still go either way. And that's a pretty important little detail. Okay? And it seems to me that Tolkien, you know, when he writes that for The Lord of the Rings, he might have this passage in the back of his mind that for Gollum, not all is lost. And we're going to even see at the very end of the Lord, well, not quite at the very end of The Lord of the Rings, at the very end of the history of the ring, let's say, Gollum's going to, you know, everybody in here has read Lord of the Rings, right? Or seen the film, at least. Which I can't really say because it's so different. I mean, towards the very end, you know, Gollum is going to attempt to take the ring from Frodo on Mount Doom. And Frodo is going to cast him off. And we're going to get this scene where kind of Sam looks at Frodo and it's like Frodo suddenly grows and he's dressed in white and he's got a wheel of fire burning on his chest. And out of the wheel of fire, a voice comes and it says to Gollum, "Be gone. Don't touch me. If you ever touch me again, you will be cast yourself into the fires of Orodruin and destroyed." Okay, we're not really clear whether that's Frodo's voice, somehow magnified through a, you know, giant amplifier in his chest, or if it's the ring speaking, because it's described as a ring of fire. Frodo turns and goes, and Sam's thinking, now I'm going to kill the dirty, rotten little SOB, who banged me on the head, by the way, just before this. Sam pulls out his sword, and Gollum says, don't kill us, no, not yet, pity, pity, please. Dust, yes, dust, everything is dust, and to dust we'll turn. And he begs for mercy. And Sam looks at Gollum at that point, and Sam remembers he wore the ring for a few hours, and he can't do it. Why? Sam looks at Gollum and he says, that could have been me. He carried the ring. Now, Sam doesn't think all of this. But Sam knows. Gollum carried the ring for how long? Hundreds of years. Yeah. It's like 600 years he had the ring. Well, I'll take that back. It's like 500 years. Because Bilbo had it for, you know, 50 years himself. 61 years himself. Okay. And then Frodo's had it for another long time. But he sees Gollum there, and he lets him live. Well, and then what happens? Gollum fulfills the quest, not Frodo. Frodo is a complete and utter failure. Frodo is not the hero of The Lord of the Rings. Neither is Gollum, it's somebody else, okay? It's not Gandalf, it's not Aragorn, it's not Boromir, it's not Legolas, it's not Gimli, it's not Merry, it's not Pippin. Okay.
I don't know, I couldn't tell where you were leading there. Yeah.
So, he sees, Bilbo, you know, perceives Gollum and sees all this, and what does he do? He jumps. He doesn't have to kill Gollum, so he doesn't. He doesn't even strike at him, he just... you know, does a pirouette over him. He gets out of and away from Gollum. He escapes the goblins. He runs out of the frying pan and into the fire. Next chapter. Now, Notice, he gets out of the mountains, and he hears a voice. And Bilbo's thinking, I'm going to give them all a surprise. And we're told, page 86, this is the second chapter of Out of the Frying Pan Into the Fire, and we're going to move more quickly from here on. They were discussing everything that happened, and the dwarves were grumbling. They do that a lot, don't they?
Yeah.
Okay? And Gandalf was saying that they can't go on without Bilbo. And he says, after all, he's my friend, and not a bad little chap.
But don't worry, any moment now, Bilbo's going to save Thorin from Azog the Goblin. And then
shut up. Just shut up. The dwarves wanted to know why he had ever been brought at all. Why he could not stick to his friends and come along with them, and why the wizard had not chosen someone with more sense. He's been more trouble than use to us so far. If we have got to go back now into those abominable tunnels, then drat him. Okay? And Bilbo suddenly shows up. Slips off the ring. He talks about the riddle with riddles with Gollum. Gandalf has questions to ask, and we're told the wizard, page 88, to tell the truth, never minded explaining his cleverness more than once. So now he told Bilbo that both he and Elrond had been well aware of the presence of evil goblins, blah, 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 blah. Okay, we'll go on from there to Land of, I'm skipping the part where the wargs and goblins come out and the eagles rescue them. They get taken to just almost the edge of Rivendell. They go on to Rivendell. And they leave it. Hold on a second. And they make their way to Beorn's house. And what is Beorn?
A skin changer.
A skin changer, or a changeling, if you want. No, not a changeling, sorry. Shapeshifter. His name is Old English word for man or warrior. Okay. Beorn is one of the most interesting characters in all of Tolkien's, I think at least, in all of Tolkien's work, partially for the simple reason that he doesn't give any more detail about him. What was your question, Gregory?
Do you mean Mirkwood, Lisa Rivendell? Or Rivendell was earlier, right?
Yeah, they've already gone. Yeah, I just skipped over Rivendell, and they go on to Beorn's place. Because Tolkien doesn't tell us any more about him. He's referenced once in The Lord of the Rings. When Frodo is sitting up on Amon Hin at the breaking of the fellowship. And he's got the ring on and he sees the world and he's able to see great distances and everything. And he sees fire and goblins and stuff in the land of the Beornings, okay, which is Beorn's world. Why does Gandalf take them to Beorn? Okay.
He knows the area. I mean, like, he's part of the... he rules that area, basically.
Okay.
He's in charge.
He's loyal, protective. Is he friendly? Is he gentle by any means? No. Is he trustful?
Not really.
I mean, he's not really trustful of others. I mean, Gandalf and the dwarves tell him the story about the fight against the wargs, and what does Beorn do? Yeah, he goes and gets, you know, as Othello will say to Iago about Desdemona's so-called infidelity, he gets the ocular proof. He goes and looks for himself and comes back and says, okay, now I know what you told me was true. Now we can relax a little bit, and you can drink and have mead and I'll fatten you up, etc. And he does. Notice, he fattens them up. They stay there for a few days. He fattens up their ponies. He gives them all kinds of supplies. And then what kind of advice does he give them about Mirkwood?
Well, stray from the path.
Don't stray from the path. Okay? Stay on the path. And what do? Almost immediately when they step foot inside Mirkwood.
Is Beor supposed to be some sort of personification of Tolkien's earlier commentary on the ills of industry? Is this very naturally connected? Naturally industrious?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, he's kind of Tolkien's version of the noble savage. He has no, I don't want to use technology in its, only in its bad sense, because even Beorn has technology. A beehive is technology, if you think of it. I mean, in terms of a man-made or constructed beehive. You know, an axe or a mattock is technology. It's anything that you use to make another job simpler or more productive. That's technology. I mean, a pen is technology. A comb is technology, essentially. So it's not that Tolkien is anti-technology. He's anti-machine. He doesn't like machines. And not because they make life easier. He wasn't against easiness of life. He didn't like, you know, that kind of technology because of what it did to humanity in its relationship with nature. It removed humanity from nature so that we created this divorce between humanity and nature. And with Beorn, you see no such divorce. Mm-hmm. Beorn is totally connected to nature. Notice what we're told, you know, is primarily his diet.
Honey.
Mead, honey, and curdled milk. Or, you know, like cottage cheese. Okay? That's it. Notice, he doesn't eat meat. Why not?
Because they're his friends.
Yeah, because he is meat. In you know, apparently at night, when he changes,
he's not just a bear, right?
Become
a bull.
Is
it a horse?
Actually, Gandalf does mention something about he usually takes the form of a bear.
Yeah, he does say that he usually takes the form of a bear. Hold on a second. Page 108. He changes his skin. Sometimes he is a huge black bear. Sometimes he is a great, strong, black-haired man with huge arms, great beard. Cannot tell you much more. Some say he's a bear descended from the great and ancient bears of the mountains that lived there before the giants came. See, like, that's one of the things I would love to hear more about, but he doesn't go into it. Others say he's a man descended from the first men who lived before Smaug. He says, I don't know. He's not the sort of person you ask questions from. He keeps cattle and horses nearly as marvelous as himself. They work for him, talk to him. He does not eat them. Neither does he hunt or eat wild animals. He keeps hives and hives of great fierce bees as a bear ranges far and wide. And he says, I've heard him growl in the tongue of bears. So that's pretty much it. And you get an illustration on 113, if your book has it. All of these drawings, by the way, are Tolkien's. I mean, the guy was an amazing artist. Not last summer, summer of 2013, when I took my Harry Potter students to Oxford. They were having an exhibit at the Bodleian Library. And it was something about modern mythic tales. And it was about the writers and their artwork. And it included, you know, Tolkien's manuscripts and some of his paintings. It included Lewis's manuscripts, I think for Chronicles of Narnia, and a couple of his drawings. Philip Pullman's Dark Material stuff, J.K. Rowling stuff. It was about magic and fairy tales or something like that. And it included books from going back to, I think the earliest one was 14th century manuscript, alchemical manuscript, with all kinds of alchemical symbols and manuscripts of John Dee, famous Renaissance magician, mathematician, wizard, as he called himself, you know. But the reason I wanted to point this out is, you know, when Tolkien drew this, he probably had in mind a classic image of an Anglo-Saxon hall, because that's what this is. I mean, this is perfect for it. Everything with the hearth at the center, hole in the roof at the top, big posts holding up the rafters, etc. When these things are discovered in England, and they are discovered on a rate of about one every year or two, they discover new hinges like this, or that outlines and the remains of the post holes and stuff. I mean, they have this shape, right?
You would think, right, like that they could recreate that in a film, right? But no, it doesn't look anything like that.
They stay with Bjorn. He gives them the advice. They leave. I skip a bunch. They go into the forest. You get captured by the spiders. Sting gets its name.
Oh, wait. Did you skip over the river? Or did the river
come? Which river?
The
one that messes
river,
up
all.
The one that Bomber falls in and falls asleep in? I did.
Yeah. It's funny you should do that, right? Because they did that in the movie, right? And I remember thinking, these are three-hour movies. You have no right to skip anything.
Well, yeah, I mean, you would think there that they would embellish, you know.
But they have the gall to release extended editions
of
films. And the river's in there, except for there's no boat. They cross with vines, because apparently boats are inherently uncinematic.
Swinging dwarves. Like dwarf tossing. And, but I do want to pick up on 154. This is after they're captured by the elves. We'll take that back. Yeah, it is. And we get a description of the elves, the wood elves. And it's the chapter, or it's the paragraph that begins, "The feasting people were wood elves. They differed from the high elves of the West and were more dangerous and less wise." And what Tolkien probably means by that is they didn't sit and deliberate as long about what to do with prisoners as the high elves would. For most of them, skipping the part in parentheses, were descended from the ancient tribes that never went to faerie in the West. Now, that's another little indication that Tolkien is linking the world of his audience with our world. I mean, the world of his audience with the world in the poem by using the word faerie. He doesn't use that word, especially with that spelling, at all in Lord of the Rings.
Or
never.
He doesn't even use it again in this book.
He doesn't use it here, not with this spelling. He does use the spelling F-A-I-R-Y. Because he talks at one point about, I think, men going off to find fairy wives somewhere. I noticed it today when I was rereading.
Yeah, I actually remember that.
Okay, the fairy in the West, that's Valinor. That's the land of the gods and such. There, the light elves and the deep elves, there are no deep elves in the Silmarillion. You have the high elves, and then you have lower elves. You do have dark elves, okay, which are those that the wood elves are descended from. But there, that is in Faerie, the light elves and the deep elves and the sea elves went and lived for ages, grew fairer and wiser and more learned as a result of their interactions with the Maiar and the Valar, and invented their magic and their cunning craft in the making of beautiful and marvelous things, which, of course, as we all know, it's not magic. The elves don't practice magic, okay? Before some came back into the wide world. In the wide world, the wood elves lingered in the twilight of our sun and moon, but love best the stars. Now keep in mind, this is the group that, Lord of the Rings, Legolas will descend from. Okay? So they get captured, all except for Bilbo. He rescues them, takes them in the barrels, and I'm skipping a bunch because I want to get to just about the last two or three chapters. They make their way to the Lakemen, speak to the master and such. The master lets them stay for a while. Bilbo gets over his cold. They get reprovisioned, and they make their way out to the Lonely Mountain. And page 192, 93, just before chapter 12. Thorin says, "Tomorrow begins the last week of autumn. Bifur and winter comes after autumn. Dwalin and next year after that. And our beards will grow till they hang down the cliff to the valley before anything happens here. What's Balin's point? Or Dwalin's point? What are we waiting for? We sit here and time goes by and our beards get longer. What is our burglar doing for us?" Now, what could Bilbo at this point say?
Everything. Saved your life.
Flies. Excuse me. Spiders. Saved you from those. What else? Yep. Saved you from those.
Got you out of prison.
Okay. Yeah. Got you out of prison. You know, where you would have rotted pretty much the rest of your lives. Bilbo heard this, and he thought, good gracious. So that's what they're beginning to think. Okay. So they see the thrush, and the thrush is, you know, cracking on the side of the wall. Bilbo remembers what Elrond told them about when you hear the thrush crack and in Durin's day, the light of the west, blah, 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 blah. Thorin puts his key in, they unlock the door. And we finally hear chapter 12, Inside Information. Now is the time for our esteemed Mr. Baggins, who has proved himself a good companion on our long road, and a hobbit full of courage and resource far exceeding his size, and if I may say so, possessed of good luck far exceeding the usual allowance, now is the time for him to perform the service for which he was included in our company. Now is the time for him to earn his reward. In other words, you know, that attempted pickpocketing back with the trolls? No, no, no. Even if he had gotten something then, that didn't count. So, Bilbo says, "If you mean you think it is my job to go into the secret passage first, O Thorin, Thrain's son, Oakenshield, may your beard grow ever longer. Say so at once and have done. I might refuse. I have got you out of two messes already, which were hardly in the original bargain, so that I am, I think, already owed some reward." This is Bilbo's way of saying, I'm altering the terms of our agreement. But third time pays for all. And he goes in. And we're told on the next page, the most that can be said for the dwarves is this. They intended to pay Bilbo really handsomely for his services. They had brought him to do a nasty job for them, and they did not mind the poor little fellow if he would. But they would all have done their best to get him out of trouble if he got into it, as they did in the case of the trolls at the beginning of their adventures, before they had any particular reasons for being grateful to him. But did they get him out of trouble? No. They got into trouble. Okay. Gandalf got them all out of trouble. Then notice what the narrator says. There it is, colon. I think Peter Jackson missed this part. Dwarves are not heroes, but calculating folk with a great idea of the value of money. Some are tricky and treacherous and pretty bad lots. Some are not, but are decent enough people like Thorin and company, if you don't expect too much. Now, what does that final phrase suggest? What if you do expect too much?
They're laid down.
Yeah. Then Thorin and company are going to let you down. Even the really good dwarves in the group, like Balin. Balin is pretty much entirely described in positive terms.
Or Feely and Keely.
or feeling killing.
While they didn't jump to volunteer, they were the ones closest to doing it, and the ones that died protecting them.
Okay. So, why did Gandalf say at the beginning that he settled on a burglar? Warriors are off fighting each other, and there aren't any heroes in this part, or in these parts. What's that tell us? The dwarves are
not heroes.
Not, well, they're not warriors either, and they're not heroes. So we're going to get a burglar. We're going to get a thief. In Anglo-Saxon tradition, the thief is the lowest thing on earth. The thief is the lowest kind of crime you could do. I mean, it's really even worse than murder. Okay? So. So Bilbo goes in. He walks down, and I was going to pull this up on the computer, but do it. I'll tell you what to look for. He walks down, and he sees Smaug. And we're told, page 198, he gazed for what seemed an age. Before, drawn almost against his will, he stole from the shadow of the doorway across the floor to the nearest edge of the mounds of treasure. Above him, the sleeping dragon lay, a dire menace even in his sleep. He grasped a great two-handled cup as heavy as he could carry, cast one fearful eye upwards. Smaug stirred a wing, opened a claw. The rumble of his snoring changed its note, and pew, Bilbo's out of there. Okay? Here's what I recommend you do. Whether you've seen the film or not, do a Google search for the name Richard Boone, Boone with an E on the end, Smaug. And click on the first YouTube hit, and what you'll see is a clip of the 1977 Rankin and Bass comic cartoon version with Richard Boone, great actor, largely Western actor, doing the voice of Smaug. But when you do that, on the right-hand side of that YouTube page, there will be a bunch of other clips listed. I think the very first one, it's either the first or second, is comparison of the 1977 and the 2013. Okay. And you'll get a comparison clip of Richard Boone doing Smaug and Benedict Cumberbatch doing Smaug. Okay? Watch those two. I mean, all you do is click on the link and it'll do Boone's version and then it morphs into Cumberbatch's version. And what you'll get is when Bilbo goes back down and he talks to Smaug. We're going to look at that quickly and then I'm going to back up for a second. Bilbo goes down on page 204. We hear Smaug say, "Well, thief, I smell you and I feel your air. I hear your breath. Come along." Watch those comparisons because I want to know next week what you think of them. Which one, you know, if you had your druthers, which one you would prefer? Because I know which one I do. I've not seen the film, but I've seen the clips of Cumberbatch. And I love Benedict Cumberbatch. He really is a fantastic actor. He's woefully underutilized, obviously. I don't think he has the voice for Smaug.
As is every single actor in those movies, though. Like,
yeah. Well,
except maybe Sylvester McCoy. Sylvester McCoy probably.
I have no idea who that is.
Radagast. He plays Radagast in the movies.
Yeah. See, that's. I saw the first one. I saw Radagast. I pretty much closed my eyes for the rest of the movie. Oh. I go see movies now, and a Hobbit trailer comes up. I close my eyes. Okay, but I want to go back for a second to page 202. This is after Smaug has come out. Okay. Paragraph that begins, "When morning came, the terror of the dwarves grew less." And I only want to look at one word in this paragraph, and it's in the next sentence, where Smaug is described as a guardian. Now, I could be entirely off on this. 202. They realized that dangers of this kind were inevitable in dealing with such a guardian.
Ah, there it is. Yeah.
And that it was no good giving up their quest yet. I think that when Tolkien wrote this, and I could be entirely wrong, okay? I'm sure when I put this up on YouTube, I'll probably get people writing from around the world saying, you're entirely wrong. I think Tolkien had in his mind an old English word there. And the word was hirda. Because the word hirda has a variety of meanings. It means guardian. It means protector. It means lord. It means herd, as in shepherd or a herder. Okay? But he gets the word lord for Lord of the Rings from a passage in Beowulf. That is, if I remember correctly, it's Hirdahringa. I think that's it. It's either that or it's Hirdabeagas. Both of those mean lord or guardian or protector, etc., of the rings. Now, skip on down next paragraph or so. Smaug has come out.
Wait, hold on. You made the association with the word, but like, okay, what's your conclusion from the association of the word?
I'm just saying that, you know, he uses that word guardian, which is French. Uh-huh. But I think he uses it, but he has in mind that old English word.
Uh-huh.
Hirda. Okay? And all I'm saying there is, Tolkien is so influenced by the Anglo-Saxon language that he's probably, when he's composing this, I think he's partially thinking, you know, the Anglo-Saxon language and what Anglo-Saxon would be there. Guardian, you know, if you were to use, no, I can't even say that. I was going to say, if you're going to use native English, it'd be ward, but that doesn't even work because ward and warden are not Old English, they're French.
Or could it, I don't know, when I read that and saw guardian, the connotation was more positive.
Yeah.
It, because when he is killed and the treasure is released, war ensues and people. And
guardian, I mean, when we think of guardian, it is more protector. But that Old English word, hirda, which has that connotation, guardian, really means more lord. What is Smaug at this point?
He's king of the mountain.
Yeah, he's kind of king of the mountain. He's lord of the treasure. He's not only a guardian of it, okay? Look at the next paragraph. What are the dwarves doing? Then, as is in the nature of folk that are thoroughly perplexed, they began to grumble at the hobbit. That is, they're perplexed because they don't know what to do. Smaug's, you know, terrorizing the countryside. They blame him for what at first seemed so pleased them. He steals the cup. Bilbo's like, what do you want me to do? I was not engaged to kill dragons. That is warrior's work, but to steal treasure. I made the best beginning I could. Do you want me to go back and bring the whole horde out? It would take 50 of me, he says, you know. Or it would take me 50 times as big, and I should want 100 times of years to do it. So, he does say, I'll do something. Next page. I'll make you an offer. I've got my ring and we'll creep down this very noon and see what he's up to. He should be asleep. And they say, yeah, do it. That's when he goes down and he has his conversation with Smaug. Now, notice what our narrator tells us. The longer, I almost said Beowulf, the longer Bilbo talks with Smaug, what happens to Bilbo?
He gets cocky.
Yeah, he gets cocky, he gets complacent, he gets lulled into lack of mental sharpness. And so what does he do?
Insults the dragon, reveals too much.
He reveals too much. You know, what does he say? I am the clue finder, the web cutter, the stinging fly. I was chosen for the lucky number. I'm he that buries his friends alive and drowns them and draws them alive again from the water. I came from the end of a bag, but no bag went over me. Bag end, bag ends. Okay. I am the friend of bears and the guest of eagles. I am ring winner and luck wearer. I am one too many. Barrel rider. Smaug knows about the barrels that come from the Misty Mountains, or excuse me, from Mirkwood to the Lake Town. And that's why he says, that's better. Now he knows you've come from Lake Town. Okay? So, Smaug leaves to go destroy Lake Town. Bilbo steals, confiscates, however you want to term it, the Arkenstone. They tell the thrush goes and tells Bard. Bilbo leaves the dwarves, takes the Arkenstone, goes down, is captured, as he wants, and he gives it to Bard. For what purpose?
He's trying to use the English. He's trying to peace weave, basically.
Yeah, he's trying to weave peace. He says, you can use this as a bargaining chip. It's the thing that Thorin wants most of all. And he says, and I'll give it to you. He doesn't tell Bard, I will take this, I will count this as my 14th. But he does later when he goes back to Thorin. He goes back to Thorin. Bard says, I've got the Arkenstone. Thorin wants to kill Bilbo, but he lets him go eventually after Bilbo says, I took it as my 1/14th. Thorin says, I'll give 1/14th of the treasure to you, Bard. But, you know, there's still some difficulties to arrange. And we get, I'm skipping a bunch, the gathering of the chapter, the gathering of the clouds. Page 236, which should be about the third page. There's a long passage I want to read and discuss briefly. Let's see. Roak the Raven, I believe, is speaking. Yes. And he says, so much for joy, Thorin Oakenshield. You may go back to your halls in safety. All the treasure is yours for the moment. But many are gathering hither beside the birds. The news of the death of the Guardian has already gone far and wide, and the legend of the wealth of Thror has not lost in the telling during many years. Many are eager for a share of the spoil. Already a host of the elves is on the way, and carrion birds are with them, hoping for battle and slaughter. But by the lake, men murmur that their sorrows are due to the dwarves, for they are homeless, and many have died, and Smaug has destroyed their town. Blah, 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 blah. Okay? So, that's when Bilbo goes back. Bard parleys with him on page 241, with Thorin, that is. And on 241, Bard appeals to something in Thorin. What's he appealing to? Perhaps wrongfully.
His heritage? His honor?
Yeah, his honor. Bard says, I am by right descent, the heir of Geryon of Dale, and in your hoard is mingled much of the wealth of his towns and halls, which of old Smaug stole. Is not that a matter of which we may speak? That is, all that treasure isn't yours.
Yeah, he took some from us.
Some of that belongs to me now. Further, in his last battle, Smaug destroyed the dwellings of the men of Escaroth, and I am yet the servant of their master. I would speak for him and ask whether you have no thought for the sorrow and misery of his people. They aided you in your distress. And in recompense, you have thus far brought ruin only. And notice, Bilbo thinks that Thorin would see the justice in these words. He did not, of course, expect that anyone would remember that it was he who discovered all by himself the dragon's weak spot. But he also did not reckon with the power that gold has upon which a dragon has long brooded. Because in Tolkien's creation, dragons are evil. Okay, the dragon in Beowulf isn't evil, personified, as it were. These dragons are, nor with dwarvish hearts. Long hours in the past day, Thorin had spent in the treasury, and what? The lust of it was heavy on him. In other words, Thorin is almost kind of becoming dragonish. The hoard is his. It's all his. Though he had hunted chiefly for the Arkenstone, yet he had an eye for many another wonderful thing that was lying there, about which were wound old memories of the labors and sorrows of his race. And what does Thorin hear from everything Bard says?
We want your money.
Yeah. Yeah.
In my 3010 class, we were just going over Beowulf, and one of the things we discussed was that in Anglo-Saxon thinking, dragons were people, like, were people who had become consumed by greed. So that's kind of what Smaug was, and that's kind of what Thorin's becoming.
Yeah, there's one other dragon in Old Northern literature, Fafnir, who had been a man or a dwarf, laid on a dragon's hoard, and was turned into a dragon because of his greed. Okay, dragons are emblematic, okay, representative of avarice. Okay,
and, if I remember correctly, you're, in your 3010 class, you discussed the possibility that Beowulf's dragon may have also been like some sort of...
A scholar named Raymond Tripp argued in a book that the dragon in Beowulf was actually the same person who put the treasure in the ground. That was the hoard that the dragon later came and found. Tripp argues this in a fairly lengthy book. Very, very few Anglo-Saxon scholars accept that theory. So, Thorin asks, it's in my mind to ask what share of their inheritance you would have paid to our kindred had you found the hoard unguarded and us slain. What would you have given to our relations? Bard says, that's a just question, but you're not dead and we're not robbers. The wealthy may have pity beyond right on the needy that befriended them when they were in want. Notice, the wealthy may have pity beyond right, that is, beyond what is rightfully theirs, that is, those who are deserving of pity. Okay? He seems to be saying, you owe us pity.
Well,
and you are now so wealthy, you ought to share some of it.
One of the things that he says, I don't remember exactly where, but he says, you know, this is owed to us, this portion of it. But, you know, something along the lines of, if you have a kind heart, there are a lot of people who are hurting because of this. And you've got a lot now, so why don't you share some of it, please?
So, Thorin sees, you know, elves down there. And he's like,
you dicks.
Yeah, you're bringing in elves? No, the elves and I aren't getting along very well. And that's when Bilbo goes down with the Arkenstone. Sorry, I had it in the previous chapter earlier. Bilbo takes the Arkenstone and he goes down and talks to Bard, page 248. Says, here's the Arkenstone. It's the heart of the mountain. It's what Thorin wants most of all. How is it yours to give? He says, well, you know, it isn't exactly, but I'm willing to let it stand against my claim. That is, I get a claim of 1/14 of everything. I'll let this stand for that. So, I'll give it to you, and then you can tell Thorin. Here is 1/14 of the claim. So, I mean, you would think 1/14 of everything that's there would probably pretty much settle Bard's debts, or the debts with Bard.
Doesn't he originally demand 1/12?
Who?
Bard.
I don't remember if he did or not. The Elven King looks at Bilbo and says, you are more worthy to wear the armor of elf princes than many that have looked more comely in it. And then Gandalf finally shows up. Well done, Mr. Baggins. Notice, Gandalf approves of this plot. Okay. Bilbo wants to know where you've been. Gandalf says, I'll tell you later. But now things are drawing to a head. And what does he mean? We're getting ready for the Battle of Five Armies. Okay. Bard shows Thorin the Arkenstone. Bilbo says, I gave it to him. And Thorin says what? You miserable hobbit, you undersized burglar. By the beard of Durin, I wish I had Gandalf here. Curse him for his choice of you. May his beard wither. As for you, I will throw you to the rocks. And the old man, who holds up the Arkenstone, says, stay, your wish is granted. And it's Gandalf. If you don't like my burglar, please don't damage him. Put him down. Listen first to what he has to say. Okay? So, just before Bilbo leaves, we find out, Gandalf says, there's a battle coming. The wargs and the goblins have come, and they're going to battle with us, and there will be the Battle of Five Armies, top of 256, upon one side were the goblins, the wild wolves, on the other were elves and men and dwarves, and the battle lasts 4 pages, and that's it. And we get the return journey. I'm not going to talk about the battle at all. Bilbo is found. He's taken to Thorin. And we're told, page 262, second page of the chapter. There indeed lay Thorin Oakenshield, wounded with many wounds, and his rent armor and notched axe were cast upon the floor. He looked up as Bilbo came beside him. Farewell, good thief. I go now to the halls of waiting to sit beside my fathers until the world is renewed. Since I leave now all gold and silver and go where it is of little worth, I wish to part in friendship from you, and I would take back my words and deeds at the gate. Okay, now, what has Thorin just acknowledged?
His own folly.
Okay, his own folly, his own foolishness. What else?
Pointlessness of material wealth.
Yeah. So. The pointlessness of gold. I mean, the point of, as an example, the point of, let me rephrase this, one of the points, one of the themes of the Old English poem, The Wanderer, is that pursuit of gold and wealth will not last, will not land you anything. I mean, the poet makes a very clear point, you know. Someone who wants to have gold strewn in their grave at their burial, it won't do them any good. You take into the grave what you brought out of the womb. Nothing. And then, shortly after that, you get the great ubisunt motif, or passage, in The Wanderer. Where now is the horse? Where is the rider? Where is the king? Where is the person who polished the cup? Where is the minstrel? Where is the harp? All is now lost.
So he has to look to things that are more
important
and beyond.
And the poet of The Wanderer says, you want to find stability? Because shortly after that, he gives the other motif, which I can't remember what it's called off the top of my head, where he says, here, life is fleeting. Here, wealth is fleeting. Here, friend is fleeting. Here, woman is fleeting. Here, man is fleeting. All this transitory life on earth will lie in idleness. And he ends the poem and says, you want to find stability? You want to find permanence? Seek it in heaven. Okay? Thorin has just learned, let's say, gold doesn't do you any good. The lay of the last survivor in Beowulf, the person that Ray Tripp says laid on the treasure and turned into a dragon, the last survivor, when he buries all this treasure in the ground, says, hold now, O earth, all this gold. Why? Where it will do as much good here as it has ever done before. That's it.
Okay.
He says, what did all this gold do for my tribe? Nothing. What did it bring them? Death. What does it bring at the end of the poem? According to one reading of the poem, the gold is still cursed, even after Beowulf kills the dragon for it. And when Wiglaf brings it all out, and all the people of the gates bring it out and touch it and handle it, they're each cursed. What happens to the gates at the end of the poem? They're wiped out. The poet makes clear. That's what's going to happen. Guess what? Historically, after about the year 800, nobody is referring to the gates anymore. They no longer exist. They did exist, we know, historically. Helak was a real king of them. But sometime, 500 to 800, they disappear. Okay?
Now, you mentioned before that that there's not really any... You said that there wasn't really any like afterlife or...
For the dwarves, I know. And Thorin... Thorin here says, waiting to sit beside my fathers until the world is renewed.
Might just mean in the ground.
Yeah, it could just mean in the ground. In the Lord of the in Tolkien's Silmarillion, there's nothing in there that suggests the dwarves will be revivified when the world is made anew. In the Silmarillion and in the History of Middle Earth, trying to remember, I think it's Morgoth's Ring is the volume of it. There is a tale called Tale of Annabeth or something like that, where we hear this story of this wise woman and this elf talking, this elf lord talking. And the elf lord wants to know, what's this stuff we hear about humanity? And she alludes to this saying that Eru Ilúvatar will enter the world, will take on the form of a man, and will bring men back to himself. Okay, now that's Tolkien taking straight Christian theology, like straight out of the New Testament, straight out of, you know, Athanasius the Great's The Incarnation, and incorporating it into his whole mythical world. Why? Because he wants to tie it ultimately to what he calls the one great true story.
I think it's interesting because, like, wasn't Tolkien critical of Lewis's, I mean, I realize that a lot of it was just like,
But notice the difference there. He's not introducing Christianity. Even in that setting, okay, and that's something Tolkien leaves unpublished at his death.
Yeah.
It was, frankly, never meant for our eyes to see. The Silmarillion was never meant for our eyes to see.
Incidentally, that was actually another question I wanted to ask. Since the Silmarillion wasn't meant to be published, are we confident that it was finished?
It wasn't finished by Tolkien. His son had to pull stuff together, rearrange stories, and you can tell that really when you look at the History of Middle-earth, the 12 volumes, because there's stuff that seems to be in the Silmarillion connected that in the History of Middle-earth isn't as quite clearly connected. So Bilbo says, farewell, king under the mountain. He says, I'm glad I've been able to share in your perils. It's been more than any Baggins deserves. Thorin, no, this is, you know, really important statement. There's more in you of good than you know, child of the kindly West. Now, when he calls him a child of the kindly West, he means two things. He means kindly West, the West of Middle Earth, where Bilbo lives, Hobbiton in the Shire. But he also means child of the kindly. He means you have like a fairy quality about you. Okay? Much as in The Lord of the Rings, Frodo will tell Faramir, you remind me an awful lot of Gandalf. When he does that, he's saying, Faramir says, that's because you see the lineage of Westernessa in me. Now, Gandalf doesn't have any of the lineage of Westernessa, but Gandalf is a Maiar, or a Maia. He's a godlike, angelic-like creature. And Frodo sees this kind of angelic-like nature in Faramir. Thorin, some courage and some wisdom blended in measure. He's saying, that's what I see in you, Bilbo. Guess what? That is the exact same thing that Hrothgar tells Beowulf he has. Okay? Courage and wisdom. In Latin, it's sapientiae, wisdom, et fortitudo, courage. Guy named Caskey, I believe it is. R.E. Caskey wrote an article in the late 60s on Beowulf called Fortitudo, Sapientiae et Fortitudo as the controlling theme of Beowulf. It's a really, really good article. Because what we see in Beowulf is we see a lot of characters who have a lot of strength, but they're not very bright. And we see other characters who have a lot of wisdom, but they lack strength. For example, at the time when the poem opens and Beowulf has to go defeat Grendel, Hrothgar has all kinds of wisdom, but he doesn't have the strength to accompany it. Helak has all kinds of strength, but he doesn't have the wisdom. His name means lack thought. Okay? Haramode has all kinds of strength, but he lacks wisdom. Okay? Beowulf, Hrothgar says, man, you're the real deal. You've got strength and wisdom, and you temper them both. That is, they're tempered with each other. Which is why he says, you're going to make a great king someday. So, if more of us valued food and cheer and song above hoarded gold, it would be a merrier world. Now, that is almost a self-condemnation. If I was more like you, the world would be a better place. But notice, this isn't directed to self. Where is it directed? To the audience. If more of us valued food and cheer and song, if we valued, in other words, friendship or relationships, conviviality, getting together for a good time, more than material wealth, the world would be a merrier place. And he dies. Okay? But sad or merry, I must leave it now. Okay? Bilbo gets his treasure, goes away, he makes his way home, he goes through goes through Rivendell, and he gets on his doorstep just about, and we're told, Bilbo says, this is the last page, then the prophecies of the old songs have turned out to be true after a fashion. This is after Balin tells him, the new master is of wiser kind than the previous master. Very popular, for of course he gets most of the credit for the present prosperity, because the new master is Bard. They are making songs that say that in his day the rivers run with gold. Gandalf, replying to Bilbo's comment about the prophecies, of course. Why should not they prove true? Surely you don't disbelieve the prophecies because you had a hand in bringing them about yourself. Okay. What does Gandalf mean by that? Bilbo expresses surprise at the prophecies coming true. And notice the prophecies are of the old songs. Gandalf says, surely you don't disbelieve the prophecies because you had a hand in bringing them about yourself. What's he mean by that? Do you think that just because you did something that led to the fulfillment of the prophecy, that therefore it's not the prophecy being fulfilled? Because what does that show? That Bilbo inhabits a world that is what? Linked linearly with these prophecies of a long time ago. And notice the prophecies are in old songs. What does that suggest? Bilbo's also in a song. Bilbo's also in a tale. Gandalf goes on. You don't really suppose, do you, that all your adventures and escapes were managed by mere luck just for your sole benefit? You're a very fine person, Mr. Baggins, and I'm very fond of you, but you are only quite a little fellow in a wide world after all. When he says all that at the end, what's he suggesting? My affairs are much, much greater than you, Bilbo. And he says, you have played a part in what? A much bigger chess match. Okay? And he also seems to be suggesting, when he says, you don't suppose, do you, that all your adventures and escapes were managed by mere luck? Okay, if it wasn't mere luck, then what was it? Well, we're going to see next week when we do the Fellowship of the Ring. What does Gandalf tell Frodo? Bilbo was meant to find the ring, and not by the ringmaker. Okay? Let's stop there, unless you have questions. Any questions? Look at this illustration by Tolkien. Look at the size of that tunnel.
Well, he's a very well-to-do hobbit.
Yeah, but look how big he is compared to it.
Yeah.
It's like a, you know, London Underground tunnel. It's huge. And the description given in the opening pages doesn't match anything that large.
Yeah, and honestly, this is kind of odd-looking because it doesn't even look like he could reach his own doorknob without stretching.
Yeah, that's true.
Like, that just doesn't seem...
No, it is perspective, so he's farther away from the doorknob. As he comes closer to it, you would think it would...
He'd shrink.
You know, but, you know, how's he, you know... He would never be able to reach the clock to... set the time to wind it, you know.
Maybe that's why they're
there. Yeah, it could be. Okay, we'll stop there.